The Chevrolet program starring Jack Benny with Frank Black and his orchestra. Frank Black opens the program with Roll Up the Carpet. Last week, my friends, I directed your attention to that big, striking Chevrolet poster now on all the billboards. Every minute, someone buys a Chevrolet. Ladies and gentlemen, that statement is incorrect. Tonight, I take pleasure in informing you that since the Chevrolet poster was prepared, Chevrolet sales have shown such an increase that instead of every minute someone buys a Chevrolet, it should be every 40 seconds someone buys a Chevrolet. Now that, mind you, is every 40 seconds, night and day. And here are the figures to back it up. During the month of May, Chevrolet dealers reported the sale of over 65,700 cars and trucks. That's 17,500 better than May 1932. 11,800 better than April of this year. Naturally, Chevrolet is grateful to the American public for making such a record possible. A record which exceeds by 1,000 cars a day the May production of any builder of automobiles. And everybody knows why. Chevrolet is the only car giving Fisher body, no draft ventilation, fine performance, proved dependability, and unexcelled economy at prices as low as $445 FOB Flint. That's why today, more than ever before, Chevrolet is the world's largest builder of automobiles. Benny.
Hello again. This is Jack Benny, the Earth Galloper, coming to you with all the late news events, and tonight we have a big surprise for you. We are going to give you a full description of the Smelling Bear fight which was not broadcast last night. We have here our own film of this famous fight held at the Yankee Stadium, where the New York Yankees play baseball while at home. Run the film, Hank. The preliminaries are over, and Smelling and Bear are now in the center of the ring taking their instructions. What a crowd, folks. 60,000 people and only 30 vacant seats. Primo Carnera walks in and the 30 seats are filled. Carnera sits down and 2,000 people behind him get up and go home. Ah, what a crowd. Here goes the bell for the first round. Smelling and Bear walk to the center of the ring. Bear looks confident and Smelling looks German.
They are fiddling around for a minute and there they go. Bear starts off with a hard right to Smelling's jaw, and Bear counters with a hard right to Smelling's jaw. Ah, what's this? Smelling sends a hard chin to Bear's right. Bear swings a wild right to Smelling's jaw, and Bear comes back with a wild right to Smelling's jaw. Smelling's jaw seems surprised as it didn't even know that Bear was in town. They are both mixing in the center of the ring as the round ends. Smelling's round and Howard Blaney.
The Chevrolet motor car is the finest.
Round two. Both men step to the center of the ring and exchange blows. What a crowd at the Yankee Stadium. Sharkey is here sitting right over second base. Gene Tunney is also here sitting over first base. Bear sends a long left to Smelling, sending Sharkey to third and Tunney to second. None out and Bear still at bat. What a game. Hey! In the outfield, we see Lefty Grove warming up for Germany and Smelling still catching. As the bell rings, Ruth and Gehrig are seen walking through the dugout. And Howard Clady.
The Chevrolet motor car is the most economical car in the world.
Round three. At the start start of this round, Bear makes a mad rush at Smelling. But Smelling tosses a right to his nose, and Bear starts singing, "California, here I come." He sees Jimmy Melton become self-conscious and lands a right to Smelling's temple. What a blow! Watch out, Bear. 4 feet lower, it would have been a foul. Bear takes command again. He's much bigger than Moxie. What a mountain Bear is. Bear Mountain. Get it, folks? That was good. Smelling leads a right. What's that? What's that? Another fight breaks out at the ringside. Another fight. Oh, who is it? They tell me it's between a taxi driver and a tailor. Well, folks, now we have a doubleheader at the good old Yankee Stadium. The tailor lands a right to the taxi driver's jaw. Smelling blocks it and crosses a left to Bear's chin. Bear sends a wicked right to the tailor, and the tailor sends a wicked note to his lawyer for a triple play. Lawyer to Smelling to Bear. What's this? Bear sends a dozen assorted rights to Smelling's jaw while we weren't looking. He sends another right to his head, a right to the heart, and a right to the liver. As there are no more places for Bear's right, he rings the bell, ending the third round. Now, the next six rounds were nip and tuck. Bear nipped and Smelling tucked. And as there was nothing outstanding in these six rounds, I'll tell you a story. Once upon a time, there were three little bears. Mama Bear, Papa Bear, and Maxie Bear. They all lived in the woods. So one day, Poppy Bear said to Maxie Bear, "Round 10. Bear opens this round with a right to Smelling's ear and a left to the jaw. Smelling counters with a nasty look. Bear resents this and starts fouling. The referee warns Bear. Bear warns Smelling. Smelling warns Sharky, and Sharky leaves the stadium. Bear is now mad and sends another right to Smelling's jaw and a left to the head. They are now missing it. Right, left, right, left, right, left. Company, halt. What a parade. Bear looks at his watch, remembers he has a date, and there he goes, forcing Smelling to the rope. Ah, what a chance for a cigar program. He sends two rights and a left to Smelling's head, and Smelling goes down for the count of 9. 1, 2, 3.
Oh, Smelton, handsome, why don't you get up?
6, 7, 8. Are you hurt, Smelling?
9.
He gets up at the count of 9. But it's too weak to carry on, and the referee steps in and announces Max Bear the winner, which is a surprise to everyone. Now, Frank Black, who bet on Smelling, will try and play Somebody Stole Gabriel Thorne. Play, Frank. Synopsis of what happened. Mr. X was found dead in his penthouse. He was discovered hanging in midair from a chandelier, dangling from a long rope. Mary, did you find out where the rope came from?
Yes, Jack. It's kind of garbled shoelaces. Get it?
Oh, well, disregard that, huh?
Now dim your lights, folks. Get ready for thrills, romance, adventure, and the boogeyman. Not yet, Frank. Besides, we're not stealing anything. This is a mystery.
Hey, Mr. Benny, when do we have to put pay?
One mystery at a time, please. Remember, folks, last week we put the tapes in the hands of Sherlock Holmes. But nothing happened. And if we take Sherlock in advance, we'll have to give him another chance.
And those of you who have given Chevrolet a chance will admit there is no mystery attached to it.
That was Hawkshaw claiming, folks, who was always on the trail of a club. You'll have to pardon me while I put on my makeup now. I'm Sherlock Holmes, you know. Now, while we are preparing for this scene, James Melton is saying, Ah, sweet mystery of life. This has nothing to do with our mystery, folks.
Ah, sweet mystery of life, at last I found thee. I know at last the secret of it all. All the longing, seeking, striving, waiting, yearning, the burning hope, the joy and idle fears that fall. For 'tis love and love alone the world is seeking. And 'tis love and love alone that can repay. Is the end and all of living, for it is love alone that rules forever.
Again to the study of Sherlock Holmes, who is working out some new clues in hopes for a speedy arrest of the murderer of Mr. X, the Ohm of Sherlock Holmes.
To be the trouble, sir. I never saw you act like this before.
Very mysterious case. Very mysterious, Watson. Mm-hmm. Very mysterious. Watson, I must think. Bring me my piano.
The finance company took it away this morning.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Then give me my violin. Ah, no use. No use, Watson. I will never learn shuffle off the buckle.
Then why don't you try Rochester or Albany?
Albany, fine. How does it go?
Albany. Why not take Albany?
Watson. Watson, an idea just struck me. An idea just struck me. You couldn't loan me $10, could you?
Sherlock, you're wonderful. How did you get it?
I felt it. Mm-hmm. Was there anybody here to see me today?
Yes, three fellows.
What's their name?
Sir Arthur, Cohen, and Doyle.
Mm, very good, Watson. You better let me get a laugh, or you won't be on the program next week.
That's elementary, Sherlock.
Hello. Hello. This is Ohms in Boston, Incorporated. Do you want to speak to Mr. Ohms? Wait, I'll connect you with the bathtub.
I'm not taking a bath, Mary.
Well, you should be. Here, it's for you.
Who is it?
Mr. X, he wants to know how you're doing with his case.
Give me that phone. Mr. X?
Yes.
Yes, we'll find the man who murdered you. Just keep your shirt on. Yes, yes, you'll get a report. What's the address? All right. Goodbye. Put down the address, Mary. Box 32, Evergreen Cemetery.
See, he lives right next door to my great-grandfather.
Mary, see who it is. Be on your toes, Boston.
Who do you wish to see, sir?
Mr. Holmes, I've got some news for you.
Let him in. Well, young man, what can I do for you?
I have a clue to the murder of Mr. X.
You have a clue, eh? Who are you?
I'm a stool pigeon.
Oh, a stool pigeon, eh? Sit down. Mary, get him a stool.
Here you are. Here you are, Mr. Pigeon.
Mary, lock the door. Close the window and pull down the blind. Now tell me, who do you think killed Mr. X?
Well, give me $5 and I'll tell all I know.
For $5, eh? Mary, have you...
Certainly not.
Boston.
No.
How much do you want to tell all?
$5.
Here's 50 cents. Just give me a rough idea.
Well, you're a new customer. I'll take it.
Now, what's your clue to the murder of Mr. X?
Well, I saw a fellow flying over the penthouse less than a week ago. He looked very suspicious. He was flying over 200 miles an hour, and he didn't stop until he got to Oslo, Norway.
Oslo, Norway.
Yes, and when he turned around and saw me looking, he left quickly for Moscow.
Yes. Go on.
And as soon as I got to Moscow, he left for Siberia.
And how did you keep up with him?
Don't tell anybody.
A Chevrolet.
Mary, a Chevrolet.
It was a Chevrolet, folks, the most dependable car in the low-priced field.
And now, Mr. Pigeon, your face looks very familiar. What did you do before you became a stool pigeon?
You.
I thought so. Now, tell me one more thing. Did you get the name of this aviator?
Yes. His name is Jimmy Mattern.
Oh, Mattern, eh? Boston, put down that salami. Get me my airplane. There's no time to lose. We'll follow him to the ends of the world.
But, wait, sir, how did you figure he could have killed Mr. Eggs by flying over the penthouse?
Well, I'll tell you, Boston. All those aviators carry sandwiches. Now, he may have had a three-decker sandwich and dropped it. And that would kill anybody.
Sherlock, you're a bear.
Boston, you're smelling. Get the airplane.
Here you are, Sherlock. All we got is a tri-motor plane.
What's a tri-motor plane, Jack?
Plane with four motors. Boston, spin the propeller. Boston, you've got her in great shape. What was that?
The left wing fell off.
Do we need it?
Yes, I'll have to fix it.
I've got a safety pin.
Not yet. That's in the next scene.
I'm only rehearsing.
Come on, let's go. Get in, Boston. Are you coming along, Mary?
Are we going up in the air?
Yes.
Well, wait till I get my air gun.
Never mind, Ed. Get in. All right, get ready. Be careful, Mary. Be careful.
Thank you.
Sherlock Holmes and Watson are still on the trail of the murderer of Mr. X. How fast are we going, Watson?
600 miles an hour.
600 miles and I'm only in second.
We're certainly going fast. What country is this we're passing?
England.
What country?
We're too late, France.
Look, Sherlock, somebody left a sack lying on the ground.
Pack nothing, it's the Eiffel Tower.
Sherlock, you're colossal.
Hallelujah, you're a bomb. Watson, I'm afraid we're running out of gas.
Don't worry, I just put a quarter in the meter.
Good work. Look, we're crossing the Russian border.
So quick.
Remember, this is a half-hour program. Look up. Look, there's another aeroplane.
You're right, Sherlock. Maybe that's the man we want. Get closer.
Hello. Hello there. I'll see you, folks. I need two more men for my orchestra.
Hello, Frank. See you when we get back.
Are you all right, Mary, back there?
Yes, Charlie. See, this is certainly a wonderful night for flying. Look how bright the moon is. Hello, round and shiny. Why don't you come down sometime?
Sherlock, there's another plane ahead of us.
What plane?
That one straight in front of us.
That's a mosquito on your nose.
Oh, I was wondering why it bit me.
Watson, put down that cloud. What are you doing with that cloud in your hand?
For the silver lining.
Lock, isn't that another plane ahead of us?
He's right, fella. Yes, sir. Do you see it?
Yes. That might be our man, Jimmy Matter. I'll pull up alongside him. Hello! Hello! Are you Jimmy Matter?
No, I'm Jimmy Melton.
Well, that's clear enough. Did you kill Mr. F?
No, you asked me that last week.
Pardon me. Buster's getting awfully foggy now.
Yes, sir, let's be careful.
I'm afraid to go further. I think we better turn back.
Don't bother, it's foggy on this side, too.
There's a storm coming up, and the fog is getting worse.
You're right, Watson. I can't see 5 feet ahead of me.
Who killed Mr. X?
Never mind X. I've got my own trouble. Oh, what was that?
The other thing dropped off.
You see, folks, this couldn't happen in a Chevrolet, as it is safe, dependable, and does everything but fly.
We're in terrible danger. Watson, I can't control the stick.
Oh, there goes the propeller. How are we on gas?
The tank is dry.
Well, good night, folks.
And next week, ladies and gentlemen, we will continue our mystery. Who killed Mr. X? And what happened to Holmes, Watson, and Mary?
And Smelling.
Right, Watson. Play Frank.
Summer, when it's all on stream. Don't you play happy
keep right on repeating.
Century of Progress Exposition. Ladies and gentlemen, it's off to a grand and glorious start. Everybody's excited about it, talking about it, planning and figuring how and when to go. And nearly every person who's been to Chicago comes back with the same enthusiastic story. Chevrolet has stolen the whole show. That perfectly amazing World Fair factory of Chevrolets, in which cars are built right before your eyes, is a fascinating sight. It's the highest of all the high spots in 3.5 miles of thrill. Now, here's a tip, my friends, on how to get to the World's Fair the easiest way, the coolest way, and by far the cheapest way. Drive in a Chevrolet, America's most economical car. You can travel all day long, and based on average gasoline costs throughout the country, four people in a Chevrolet can cover over 200 miles for less than 40 cents apiece. Yes, you'll not only have a cooler, more restful, more enjoyable trip in a Chevrolet, but you'll have more money left to spend at the fair when you get there. On to Chicago, America. On to the World's Fair, the most economical way. In that big, thrifty, dependable six, Chevrolet.
With Mary singing, it's great to be alive. And don't forget to listen in next Friday, ladies and gentlemen, and follow our thrilling mystery, Who Killed Mr. X? Come on, Mary, I'll take you home now.
I'm sorry, Jack, I have a date tonight.
With whom? Oh, yeah, well, he'll find out. Good night, folks.
Come on, Shadow.
In the Park is from the Gold Diggers of 1933, and It's Great to Be Alive is from Strike Me Pink. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
WEIS, New York.